Folks, it is Friday, so it is time to cut loose, and we need to get knee-deep into all the Bravos comings and goings, the Beverly Hills reunion, whatever is going on with Vanderpump Rules, this chain of misery that we're attached to, and I can't think of a better guest to go over this stuff with me, and I'm so excited to not only talk to her, but talk to somebody, because when you get into those recaps solo, it's a lonely, dark place, so I cannot wait to have this conversation. She does a daily show herself. You can find it on podcasting platforms. You can find it on YouTube. She is also a brand strategist and also a casting director. So she's got real careers, folks. She doesn't need any of this stuff. But I've met her a couple of times now, and I've always enjoyed talking to her. So I can't wait to talk to her on here from the podcast Daily Dose of Donna. It is the one, the only Donna Bowling. Donna, welcome to the show.
Oh my gosh, Ryan, what an intro. You really should do this for a living.
It does. Well, it doesn't get better than that. Like, that's it for me for the show. You carry the rest of this.
We peaked. We peaked. Yeah. We're going downhill.
I want to get into all the Bravo, but really quickly, just to, if people don't know you, how long have you been doing this? And I guess with anybody that does what we do, why are you doing this?
I literally fell into it. So I was a casting director, like you said, for years and years and years here in LA. And then I started working with brand strategy and like marketing and all that. But then at the beginning of last year, I was like, I want a daily, like kind of personal podcast. And it
were you always a fan of podcasts and Bravo and all of that stuff?
100%. I teach people how to start podcasts. That's part of the content. So I'm a big, huge podcast.
You need to stop that immediately. We've got plenty now. I think we've tapped out. I'm joking.
I cut people totally off joking. If they talk about Bravo. I'm like, nope, we're out. You're not one of my only if you talk about like women's health. I'll help you. But no, market. it developed into this. I just started talking about things I like and shows I like. And I was talking about documentaries I was watching. And then, you know, a couple of things got me on the map. And next thing you know, it's been great.
Now, you say something, a couple things got you on the map. What would you consider something that got you on the map?
Well, I think you know him. His name's Jeff Lewis. Talking about Jeff Lewis. And like some
wait,
of
did you wait?
Universe.
Did you have a feud with Jeff Lewis?
No, not at all. I love Jeff.
Yeah, I was
Jeff.
Like, I saw you at the Jeff premiere thing.
Oh,
yeah,
no, I'm a huge, huge Jeff fan.
See, Donna, I don't get into like sometimes like the inner workings of like the drama behind things. Like, I run from drama a lot of the times, even if people try to pull me in. I just don't. But like, so you started, were you talking about the Jeff Heather stuff? Is that what it was?
It was actually like, I started talking about like the Heather and Megan stuff just because I was so invested in it as a Jeff Lewis listener. And I think just not a lot of, you're right, like not a lot of people talk about the podcasters or like the behind the scenes of the behind the scenes.
Yeah.
I realized very fast that while it's a very good conversation to have because there's not that many people talking about it, it's also so toxic. It was so insane.
That's it. I mean, somebody on my Patreon asked me a question yesterday, and I thought it was in regards to Vanderpump Rules in terms of like, you know, the podcasting and the toxicity. But then I think they actually meant between other podcasters. And I think that's just really, you're right though. Like, to me, the toxicity is so intense, but at the same time, it is sometimes so good for your show. And I come from like a Stern background of listening to Stern. So I used to love when he would get into fights with his staff, get his family, all of this stuff. I would love it. But then I don't personally ever want my show to be about that, even though I know it would be so good because it's exciting. It makes people feel like they're a part of something. Did you come to that same conclusion in a sense, it sounds?
Well, I just like talking about it. I didn't want to be part of the drama, but I quickly got dragged into becoming part of the drama because here's the thing. This is what I noticed. And I think this happens with the reality stars too, like the Bravo shows. It's not necessarily the talent that's creating the drama. The fans really like to pit people against each other. And I think that started to happen. Like, it started to become like, oh, Donna's saying this about this person. And oh my gosh, is there beef? Is there drama? Like, they were creating these big fights. Like right now, probably someone is out there saying that, you know, I'm having your baby.
Oh my God. Well, I don't think that's possible at this point. I think I might be shooting blanks. Who knows? For me, I think I know. Well, that is the funny thing about then actually doing this. And then you realize people are curious about you. And that is like a really kind of scary thing because I got into this to talk about all of these other things. And I sometimes find myself wildly boring. Like, I'll go out Like, you saw me at that Jeff Lewis thing in December, and that was like one of like five times I went out like the previous 6 months. So I get super nervous when I go out. Like, I don't, like, I was invited to like Sheena's like record release party for something tonight. And I was like, I'm not going to that. There's no way. No. Because, like, first off, well,
I don't want to go either.
Be honest. Well, yeah. First off, I do love Sheena, even though she's having a rough season. I do love her and I want to support her, but at the same time, don't want to bump into Tom Sandoval if he's there trying to be a friend, which, by the way, that was actually something I'm curious. Will he show up to try to show her what a good friend she is after this week's episode, how good of a friend he is? And then secondly, I don't know. It's like, I think the fascinating thing is to be able to talk about these people without having to, like, I'm trying to say, without worrying about their feelings so much, because totally. When you meet them, they become people immediately. And just like people in our own lives that make mistakes all of the time, including myself, once you get to know those people, it makes your judgment a little skewed.
100%. And I think that that's actually a problem in a lot of these places, is that people become stans of certain people because they've met them in real life, or they've had a really good experience, or maybe the opposite. And then no matter what happens on the shows, you love them or you hate them. And I try really hard to say, each episode, I can be obsessed with one person and the next week can't stand them. But I don't want to be too close to the sun. Like, yeah, I find myself, yeah, I want to talk about everyone, but I don't want to really be like, I want to go to something about her when it opens in 2029, maybe. Like, I don't know when that's going to, I want to go.
Oh my God, the fans, the people are ablaze with anger about this something about her. I mean, people are livid that it is not open yet.
And did you hear that they apparently wiped their Instagram completely clean?
I did see that today, and I saw that, and I was talking about this on the recap yesterday. Is that okay? So I know for a fact that they were trying to open, by the way, sorry, you guys, we're just getting right into it, but this is great already. I know they were planning on opening or a soft launch at the end of August, because I was invited to an opening party. Like, I personally was reached out to by Penny, who you see on the show.
Were you going to go?
I was going to go. Well, I mean, this is not to break, but it was, unfortunately, the timing was like, my mom had just died, was going to New York to start Betches. And by the way, if I could have gone, that would have been something that I totally would have gone. But then they started running into the problems with the West Hollywood zoning department. But now then, Ariana's on Broadway. They don't want to open it now. And I don't know, like, at a certain point, it does become a drain on finances. But I do want to assure people, this wasn't some scam. Like, they truly, like, the sandwiches are done, all of that stuff. So it's wild that we're so in this headspace of conspiracy theory land that people think this is some big scam now.
I think it just looks very suspect. You live here in LA. Like, if you drive Robertson or walk Robertson, it doesn't look like it existed. It looks like it was brought, like a set.
Yeah, they took down everything. They took down the awning, the furniture, and, you know, I mean, but so, they did have to do away with that whole patio. They had to like destroy all of that. I mean, maybe they took down the awning because people were pooping on the patio, which we found out a couple of weeks ago.
Was that you? Who was that?
God, no, I would never do that. I thought it was Billy Lee or Tom Sandoval personally. I thought that was one of the, you know, like, Billy, you know, Billy, like, Tom, look what I'm doing for you, Tom.
James peed on your bush. I'm going to poop on her patio.
DJ James Kennedy takes it up a notch. Like, I peed on Tom's bush, so I have to shit on your patio.
Look, I've never opened a sandwich shop, and I know that there's obviously a lot of laws and rules around zoning or whatever, but it doesn't feel like it doesn't feel like a task that you can't surpass. So it seems just strange that it hasn't. I also think that they're maybe going to try to time it out if they do eventually open. So when Ariana's available, maybe when it airs on the show, maybe the season finale, like, who knows? Maybe they'll find a time that it opens.
Yeah.
Coincidentally with the show.
But at the same time, I was trying to think about this logically, and I know Ariana a little bit, and that's why, you know, I'm speaking of like being too close to the sun. When I used to hang out with Tom Sandoval here and there, like, I really thought that dude was the coolest. And that's why I even realized in those moments, like, you got to pull back from shit like that, because, I mean, it didn't clap. Like, I was able to really give that, you know, I really said what I still say what I feel about Tom to this day. But it did make me feel bad knowing him a little bit. And that's why I was even more shocked that he did this, because it never came across in person. It came across as the Tom that you see of, like, he pays for everybody's drinks, he wants everybody to have a good time, all of this stuff. But it does cloud your overall judgment. And it just bummed me out, because I think a lot of these people, I keep saying, like, they all have pudding for brains at this point, because you see with Tom, there is such a psychosis almost about spending the last 11 years of his life on TV. And that's the scary part about being a fan of reality television, is you see the long term effects of these stars.
Yeah, I mean, I was just working out, and I turned on my TV and it's old episodes of Vanderpump. And whenever it's on, it's like you kind of can't turn away. And so it was the season 5 reunion, and Ariana and Tom were, you know, like prime couple against Stassi. They hated Stassi and Kristen at the time. And you're watching this and it's like, it's different human beings. They've become different versions of themselves through the years. I mean, what is your take on Vanderpump this season? You can't be loving it. There's no way.
No, I mean, it's painful to do the recaps, and it is, I mean, I try to find those little, like, me personally, I try to find those moments of, like, complete silliness that I can go off on and, you know, say it from a humorous slant. But if you look at it, I just keep comparing it to something that they're all chained, like there's golden handcuffs they're chained to, because in no other reality would you be encouraged to be friends this quickly with somebody. And you, like, I don't even understand, like, by the end of this week's episode, Brock is apologizing to Tom. I'm like, listen, man, you don't understand. It's, you know, I'm sorry, I came at you hard. Like, why are you apologizing to Tom? Like, Tom is expecting apologies from some of these people. And it's mind-blowing. And it also shows the voraciousness of the audience, is that then you see the anger towards Ariana, who is basically setting boundaries, which any good therapist would tell you to do. It just doesn't make for great television. But people seem to be livid. And I'm like, there is only one, maybe two people you should be extremely livid with in terms of this situation. And it's definitely not Ariana.
Yeah, it's Hippie the dog. And I feel like of all the people on that show, that dog has really ruined so many. Well, no, it has.
Hippie, no. Oh, I know.
Hippie, don't go after the cats. Ali Bali. I feel like you're right. They're being pulled into uncomfortable situations that you would never have to do. And at the same time, Ariana is it's very tough, because how can she come off kind and sweet and loving and fun right now in the time?
Somebody betrayed her.
I know. It seems crazy. So if your ex is hanging out with your best friend and she's calling you saying, I had to do an open eye meditation with him and hold his hand and talk to him and say, like, if I never see you again, how could you react to, oh, that's so sweet, babe.
I know. What are you supposed, which is also, that's what's so funny about this show, is that they allow, like, anytime a guy does something stupid on a Vanderpump Rules show, immediately you have, like, a Reiki healer or a therapist that's, like, comes Shannon. In at some point. Yeah, and I thought that was great, but at the same time, it's just, like, production is so, it's, like, cruel in a certain way, because poor Sheena is, like, literally, like, on her last legs. Like, you would have thought Sheena had dated this man for 9 years and was cheated on. She cried more on camera than Ariana has ever cried, and I think that's it, too, is that we want Ariana to be a classic victim that cannot pull herself out of a gutter. And she is not. So I think there's this internal anger towards her, because she is saying, I am not going to show my weakness on camera, even though I think a lot of people would like to see that.
Well, you know, that's so funny, because the scene that I just watched from season 5 reunion, and I totally forgot this, Stassi is asking Ariana, why do you hate me so much? You always are mad at me. You always find issues. And Ariana's like, because I don't like you. I don't like you. And then they went to a scene where Stassi and Ariana were having a conversation at Pandora's house. I mean, you can only imagine. And Ariana starts to tear up and cry about something. And Stassi says, I finally cracked her. She's the most difficult person to crack. I think Ariana as a whole is like a stone. That's kind of her vibe. And she's probably not vulnerable. Like, it just doesn't work. It doesn't happen often for her at all.
Well, I think Ariana is the, and I mean this as a big compliment, is the amazing version of Erica Jane in terms of stoniness. Like, Erica Jane, like, I'm talking, but completely opposite in intent and heart. Erica Jane will pride herself on this stoniness. And I think Ariana has always been that way. But Ariana is more like us the viewers than any of those cast members. Because like, even when I was like, I would go over to do that Tom interview, and she was up there watching Love Island, just scrolling through TikTok. Like, she's like us. I mean, she is like us. So I think take all of these opportunities, because I believe there's a world in which she chooses not to come back to this show. One, because I don't think it's good for her and she has good opportunities. And two, I really don't know how this show moves forward with, she's almost sane, and this show does not need sane people, if that makes sense.
100%. And also, I can't see this show coming back after this season.
Oh,
I really,
Donna,
don't think
you,
they
Donna,
can...
you know, this is okay. Donna,
they're going to keep
come
it
from the, well, they're going to keep it because they're making money. Like, still? Money, like, everybody acts like corporations, like, that's why the lawsuits of Bravo are so funny. It's like, guess what? Corporations don't care about you. Corporations also are there to make money, to sell soap. That's what it is. And even in its worst iteration of Vanderpump Rules season, it was still bringing in advertising revenue. They can coast for the next two seasons on how, like, even dwindling ratings, they can still coast for two seasons. And I just don't think a lot of times on TV of this stature, you don't see people doing it for the art. Like, we all go, oh, it would be so amazing if they just walked into the sunset. But that's not the reality of reality, is it? Mm-mm.
No, they're going to go from this show to another show to another show, if not Vanderpump. But do you know what the ratings are? Because I can't imagine they're even close to last season.
No, well, listen, they're still like last night's episode or Tuesday night's episode is like pulled a 0.94. So that's really still pretty good. It's not at, I mean, this is just same day viewing. It's not incorporating 7 day or anything like that. But, you know, the height, obviously that one episode, the reunion, with all platforms, it was like 12 million viewers or something.
Yeah, so I mean, that was the Super Bowl.
Yeah, I mean, it's still amazing. It's dwindling. And with 7 day, including Peacock and stuff, that will raise up. So it is still one of, if not the top show on Bravo still.
Okay, well, then they'll find a way to make it work. I'm not interested in a lot of these people anymore.
Well,
that's the problem, is like you start to wonder, who do you root for anymore in this show?
Well, yes, that's it exactly, is that. And I was thinking about this while I was, I do this thing where I like to torture myself, and I watched the 2-hour Bet It All on Blonde with Erica Jayne documentary special last night.
Here.
Yeah. And it was like, I thought, you know, it's great because we're literally watching something that the majority of viewers do not root for her at all. Like, and she doesn't make herself somebody that you want to root for, but that's like with Vanderpump Rules, like, who are we rooting for? Like, even, and this is what I think I was going to ask you in terms of covering these things daily. You know, it's not just the show anymore. It's 360 viewing, where it includes podcasts, yours, mine, theirs, TMZ, Daily Mail, Celebrity Blinds, all of this stuff. We have rumors about DJ James Kennedy. We have lawsuits. So it's not even what's presented on the show and the narrative anymore. It's all of the other stuff of like, oh shit, they're making DJ James Kennedy out to be a hero, but there's all of these things to in Rachel's court papers and Christian Doty and things like that.
Yeah, it's almost impossible to watch. And actually, someone I follow, and I can't remember who said it exactly, said something really interesting after like the first or second episode of the season, that the audience, the show is presented as if the audience is all like us and watching every TikTok and listening to all the podcasts. Because if you're just watching the show without any of this other knowledge of what's really happening behind the scenes, I think you'd be confused. How is Ariana killing it? You don't really know. Like, they're not showing her getting all these jobs. They're not showing her taking all these gigs. So the producers are almost assuming that we just like all know all the behind the scenes as the episodes are continuing. I find it all really tricky to also think about. Here's another thing. And I think I talked about this with you, is that we know now in February, March 24, right? March of 2024, we know that Tom Sandoval is still a complete jackass.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Because of the Nick Vile podcast, all of this stuff. Yeah.
So what are we like this? The only redeeming factor here would be like, wow, we get to see Tom Sandoval better himself, but he never does. Yeah. And we know he won't.
Well, listen, Donna, he's journaling now. That was a big moment for Tom. Obviously, and we haven't even gotten to the point where in the preview, we see Tom with a blindfold going, ah, and I think that's some sort of scream therapy, or what's that drug where they like
ayahuasca?
Not Iowa, but Iowa. It's like that. Bufo. Some people abuse. What's that?
I don't know. Bufo is one. No, Chrissy Cavallari just did it.
Matthew Perry actually was using this as a treatment, and then I think he abused it. But I'm forgetting the drug. But anyways, I think we're about to see that. So I think we're going to see, like, we saw a cold plunge earlier.
Ketamine therapy, where that's Adriana it, did that.
That's it. Ketamine like, therapy from Miami.
I'm crying. Oh my God. Yes. Maybe that's what he does.
Well, I think every episode is going to be one of these things that's so on the nose about bettering yourself. And the sad thing is, like we talked about, was that we know that he has not gotten there yet. And by the way, he probably shouldn't be there yet. Like, this is a huge event that happened. And if he goes straight into work without actually taking time to try to figure out his own behavior, but he's not, he's blaming everybody else for his own behavior.
Yeah. Now he's going back on tour in real life. Like right now I saw something where he has all these dates. He's going all over the country. And like, yeah, I mean, it's just, I think this is Tom's lot in life. I mean, maybe when he's like 50, I mean, he's already 40. So it's not like when he's 40, maybe when he's 60, he'll be like, oh, okay. Like maybe I should figure some shit out. But I think he's just, he's like a, he's just ready to get the next thing going. Like he's not one to want to sit in it.
Maybe. Well, that's why Rachel, I was really impressed that she actually went, checked herself in to, you know, for months. You know, I was really impressed up to a certain point, but I thought, oh, here's somebody actually working on their patterns of behavior. I think my curiosity with Rachel still, and even with the court documents, is, wow, you still want to be, it's not like you want to go out there and live a normal life. You still want to be a star in some fashion. And that always convolutes for me any argument that you make in terms of damaging, especially in reality TV, because I'm sorry, in this day and age, 2024, anybody getting into reality television has to realize people are going to profit off your pain. That's the name of the game. Like, know what you're signing up for.
Yeah. I mean, hello, Leah McSweeney. Exactly. And I feel like Raquel, you know, one thing I will always say is that Rachel, Raquel, whatever, she did not go back to Tom, which to me is like such a sign of growth. Don't you think? Like for her.
Oh my God. Yes.
I'm in shock over that still. Like, I feel like they had such a codependent relationship that for her to grow up enough during that treatment to say, like, I don't want that. And then to block him and like all the things, that part of me, I wish she just would have left it there. The lawsuit that just came out, and I get the lawsuit against Tom, I really do. But against Ariana, it's giving a little bit.
Well, I think if you're trying to, I don't think she's trying to win public approval, but that's definitely not going to do it. You know, with the Ariana thing, even though I know and I've read all the court documents, I know there is a case for the revenge porn because she sent it to herself, blah, blah, blah. But I mean, it'll be interesting to see where this pans out. I just think also when you are potentially a pawn in whatever Bethany Frankel is trying to do to this date, I think you're once again being used by somebody more powerful than you. And you're making such good decisions at this point. I just worry about her overall health, about throwing herself into. But Rachel always was very litigious because even when she had the lawyer at the very beginning, immediately sent out, you know, the send it to Daryl letter that Lala built a fortune on. Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, she sent that out to everyone. And then, of course, the restraining order against Sheena. Like, this was right off the bat. This was her deal.
This is going way too fast on us. So, wait, how long do you have just so I don't over abuse
I'm
you
here until tomorrow. We're having
okay, perfect. Over. Great. Well, that's going to cut it short, I guess, but we'll try to get it. Before I get to Beverly Hills, though, I saw something on your podcast that I wanted to talk about, which is, by the way, once again, guys, The Daily Dose of Donna. You can subscribe on all platforms and YouTube is The Valley. The Valley comes out in a couple of weeks right after Vanderpump Rules, and everybody is all on the, do we even need this? No, of course we don't need it. But now we have Brittany and Jax. They're taking some time apart. Brittany has moved into a new location. And, you know, I heard on your show that you said they are filming again for The Valley because I knew the season had wrapped because I had talked to some of the cast members. You say they're filming again.
So paparazzi have not only seen, at first we saw the kind of really, I don't think, on purpose, because Brittany did not look like she was camera ready in those first
she was in like a little scene cutoff shirt that like it was very
I was like,
you know,
whoa Brittany, this is an unfortunate moment, right? And Brittany's a pretty woman, but like she really looked like she's gone through Jax, you know what I mean?
She looked like us if we were going through relationship issues moving, like just a normal
she looked
person.
Real But she, so that was the first time we saw actual like pictures of her moving out. But since then, over the weekend, Jax was filmed with one of the co-stars of The Valley. I don't know his name, but one of the guys, and they were having lunch with cameras up here in The Valley at a restaurant. And then yesterday it was all over that Brittany was again moving out, but this time with her hair and makeup done, and there was producers and cameras.
Okay, so that makes up. I just talked about this on the recap today. I literally said I've now seen two shoots of her moving. How long is it going to take her to move? And this now makes so much more sense that they actually picked back up cameras. Now this will lead more people to go conspiracy. This was all planned. This is part of the show. What are your thoughts on that?
I mean, it could be and it couldn't be. I do believe Jax is a DB. He's a little bit of a douche canoe, but I have a friend, I have a listener who's on my Facebook group who was at the Vanderpump premiere at Jax's Studio City. So when did that premiere? Beginning of February or something. I can't remember now. And that night, Jax and Brittany got in a huge fight at the party.
In front of everybody.
Yeah, like she watched it happen because they were airing something on Bravo about like, where are they now or like where they came from or whatever. And they showed, you know, the rotten hell times. Brittany got real pissed off, drunk, left the bar. And Jax was like, what are people going to say now? Everyone's going to see you do this. So I actually think that there was serious problems in their marriage. I mean, I do believe that he has been unfaithful from what I've heard and from, you know, DMs I've gotten from, I don't know. And I think it's a real thing and it's just bad timing, but it all seems very strange because for Brittany to release the information on her podcast and then for that night, Jax to say, no, she's moving. She's fine. We're back together. And then the next day she's moving her shit out. It's so confusing. Like which story are we telling here?
It really is confusing, but you do have to go back to the fact that this man has done this repeated behavior time and time again. It's not like this was Tom Sandoval and this is a big shock. This is something that he's done again and again and again. So there is a world which is very easy to believe that he has picked up this same behavior. And this is also one of the pitfalls of Scandoval, that it did bring them back to the network and to everybody's ears and screens. Mm-hmm. But it probably led him to more bad behavior. I've gotten DMs as well from people who have had stories about, you know, Jax being unfaithful. And I don't really, I'm not a that usually that account or that. But I'm sure we've gotten similar DMs.
Yeah.
And I do. I mean, there is a world in which I believe that. But it is interesting that now the big thing is with Beverly Hills, this and Vanderpump, everybody picks back up cameras now.
Also, like, can we come up with another storyline? Like, it just is cheating. Like, it's just cheating and separation. Cheating and separation. I guess that's the most interesting thing because you can't always get a Tom Girardi story. Like, it's very rare to get the Teresa Giudice going to jail. So, like, the next best thing
Jax
is
Jax can't go to law school at this point to actually bilk anybody
out
of money.
No, but let's be honest. Watching Jax, early Vanderpump, this man was out to be famous. That's all he wanted. He wanted to be a star. He was so excited with Scandoval, as was, let's be honest, Sheena, Lala, all of them, because it really drove everyone's numbers up. It probably drove your numbers up and my numbers up.
That's what they were there to do. They make no, like, that they wanted to be stars. They were all trying to be a part of the industry.
Exactly. And we all benefited. Whenever there's huge scandal on these shows, we all benefit. That's just the way. It's a trickle-down situation. TMZ is benefiting and Daily Mail is benefiting. Everyone is. Anyway, Jax got that, like, touch of fame. He got the bar. He got his own podcast. Now he has a reality show. Yeah, I think ego gets involved in Jax's head a lot. I think he has that mustache, but that's just his ego growing.
I just think it'll be funny, though, if The Valley actually presents them as, like, growing up. And, you know, from the trailer, we see Jax is, like, giving advice to other guys. And then all of a sudden, we're going to cut and it'll be like, hey, man, I fucked around on my wife. Forget the first 8 episodes of this series. I'm so sorry. I'm so curious how you will make that shift. And that's why I'm really actually excited to see it.
Wasn't he like the most vocal anti-Tom Sandoval at the beginning of Scandoval? He came out there and he was like, what a disgusting human being. But you know how they say, thou who doth protest too much or whatever.
Well, they all know where the bodies are buried. Schwartz, Sandoval, and Jax all have so much shit on each other. But it's the funny disgusting. Thing is, Jax was the most vocal, like, against Tom Sandoval. And then I think right around the time that they started filming Vanderpump Rules, or a couple episodes, like I remember Jack's going, "Hey man, he's an okay guy. Leave him alone." Da, da, da. I'm like, wow, look, all of a sudden a change. Once you have your show and once you're filming with Vanderpump Rules, you have now changed. Like Lala, I will say, does a lot of the, Lala does it in a way better way because Lala is good with her verbiage and she is entertaining to watch. But Lala is sometimes frustrating. Even the last episode of the last line of this episode with her saying, you know, Ariana needs to pull her head out of her ass and realize who her real friends are. And I'm like, well, that wouldn't have been you, Lala. You've never been a true real friend to her. Even when she stood up for Lala in the beginning, when Stassi and all those girls were against her.
Yeah, I think she was meeting Sheena at that moment because she felt like Sheena was just like in such hell on that Tahoe trip, which we could see. I mean, I'm surprised Sheena has any more liquid in her body after crying for so many hours.
IV.
She needed one more than Dorit at that reunion. But she is like Lala basically said, like, look, clearly there's going to be some weird tension between Lala and Ariana this season. We are already seeing it coming. We've seen it in the trailers. You know, she thinks she's God, yeah, et cetera.
Yeah, I mean, it'll be interesting. And Lala, but that's the thing. Like, how does this show go on? I was trying to, like, do a map of, like, where, because Lala at this point, I mean, where does even Lala go? Like, Lala's not going to date Tom Schwartz at this point. Like, Lala's Sheena's friend, and she's going to go on her pregnancy journey here starting next week's episode. But, like, what is the whole point? Is, like, to get, like, certain people to forgive Tom and to go against Ariana getting certain things. Even Ariana's popularity, though, got her the Uber One Good as Gold remix thing.
I know. I mean, honestly, Sheena moved to Sherman Oaks or is moving to Sherman Oaks, and Lala's moving to Sherman Oaks. So maybe they join the Valley. I mean, if that's, they're like, moms,
that's the real Valley right there.
I know. And they're moms. Like, this is the Valley is about having a family. Vanderpump Rules does not, like, relate. It doesn't connect with family life. It doesn't feel like that weird show.
Well, I mean, then to look at the opposite end of the spectrum, Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, we just had our second part of the reunion last night. What do you think so far of this two-part reunion that they get you so hyped for? What do you think after watching the second part of this reunion?
I personally love watching anything Beverly Hills this season. I'm just, even though some episodes have been boring, I'm just really immersed in the characters and the storylines, and I want more. I'm interested in it. Unlike some of the other shows, you know, this I really would love. I would love an unedited version of the reunion. I want to hear everything everyone's saying to each other. But in general, I mean, we always know episode two is usually kind of like a filler episode. It's like, let's give them a little bit. But I thought we got some really good stuff between the Kyle and Sutton's thing and then the Dorit and Garcelle thing. And of course, the big Dorit and Kyle drama, which doesn't look like it's gone really away.
I think at the end of the day with Kyle and Dorit, though, Kyle, it just really seems like truly doesn't give an F about Dorit at the end of the day. Like, you know, yeah. I think they're, yeah, I just don't think that at all. So I think it is interesting that Dorit is out there fighting for her life and she's making it worse on herself. Like every time, like, and also she's now the punchline of so many jokes, even at the reunion, of like Andy yawning once again when Dorit's speaking, Andy saying, well, you didn't quite speak in bullet points, but we got there. And everybody, it's like, wow, this is a real thing with Dorit. And we see the edited down version.
Yeah. I mean, clearly it's very obvious that Dorit annoys a lot of people around her. I think she annoys Andy. I know it's an ongoing joke about the yawning, but I don't know about you, but long-winded people drive me insane. So if you're a slow talker or long-winded, those are two things I can't handle. But I think Dorit and, you know, her definition of her friendship with Kyle is confusing because Kyle confuses her. Kyle expects her to be there loyally and stand up for her as a best friend would, but then in the same sentence says, I can count on my hand how many times you and I have had lunch. Is, yeah, Dorit her good friend or not? And Dorit, honestly, all she said about Kathy in the last reunion was like, well, Kyle, I just believe that Kathy is trying to say, and Kyle like shot her down.
Yeah.
She was not don't having it. So I just don't think she likes Dorit.
No, I mean, I think that's now becoming more and more evident. And that like also worries me because what is Dorit's place on the show after this? I find that interesting as well. So Dorit, it was a lot of Dorit last night, and we found out that her and PK, we've never been better. We are amazing. And he's stopped drinking for 49 days. Supposedly PK released an Instagram, a very loving Instagram post last night.
Oh, he
during
did?
The reunion. Yeah. Yeah. Very sweet and loving.
What did he say?
Just that, you know, I think it was like 9 years of love and it's never been better, or something that it was very sweet. But also, you know, Garcelle brings up the confusion that she had in regards to the robbery about leaving the cell phone behind. In what world would that ever happen? And also, we got a very confusing story out of Dorit about going to Marshall's, which I was like, shout out to Marshall's. What a big day for Marshall's today.
Huge.
But talked about having the $10,000 in holiday tip money. And then she went to Marshall's for box carts. And then three men followed her, according to the cameras. I was still very confused. Did you make any heads or tails of what that actually meant?
She got money from the bank, and then on the way home, she said box cards. Okay.
I don't understand what
the hell a box card is. Does she mean a box of cards? Box cards. Box cards. Or maybe it's the card that you put on the box. I don't know. Anyway, and everyone said it over and over as if it was just like a normal thing. Like, I need water. Anyway, so she goes to Marshall's. I know exactly which one because it's here in Encino. It's a Marshall's Home Goods.
Is it the one that the curve in the street on Ventura Boulevard, or the one that's further down?
No, that's a different one. That's the Studio City one.
Okay.
We're talking Encino. Get a little more west.
Ryan. Oh, by Buca di Beppo. Buca di Beppo. Got it.
Always go to Buca. Buca di Beppo is the home base, and then we go from there. Okay. So she probably went in there. You can get a shopping cart at Marshall's, and you'd have to be ridiculous because I thought we learned this like in first grade, do not leave your bag unattended in a shopping cart. Also, like, how could you not notice three men following you in a store like that? It's quiet. It's not like so hustle bustle in there, but whatever. I'm not going to victim shame. I mean, poor Dorit, if she got that money stolen, I just found that was interesting.
Well, also, I mean, Garcelle was taking a little heat for actually mentioning the confusion, but I think a lot of us actually have confusion. And that's the thing. Like, even Sutton gets a lot of heat, but Sutton was actually like showing up. Like, Sutton was like, don't you tell me I have a drinking problem. What about your caucuses on the floor? You know, like, I like that she was actually showing up and not just taking the beating like some people do. And Kyle seems very pressed. Like, Kyle, which in all, like, she could like literally kind of sit back and go, really rough year, you guys, but she seems so angry and so defensive when I sometimes don't think she needs to be, which is confusing. But yeah, the Dorit stuff, I feel bad for her. I feel like...
Well, let me ask you a question. Do you believe, because I don't know exactly your thoughts, do you believe the robbery happened? Do you believe Dorit was woken up in this way in the middle of the night?
I do.
Me too. I really do. And do you believe that it's possible that it was maybe a orchestrated situation, but Dorit was not in on it and like was completely.
That to me, I've thought about as well. Like, in fact, I was talking about that, of something that Dorit might not be aware of that she was a part of. But even then, that is such a dark situation. If a gun is involved, even if it was found out to be a fake gun, for that to even be a setup situation is so dark to think about. And I just the bad luck to have three instances of robbery of some form within a short amount of period, that you would almost be like, of course she has PTSD, or as I call it, putsta. Of course she has putsta. Like, I mean, at this point, how is she even walking out of the house if this is going down?
Yeah, I mean, this is unreal to be robbed three times. And it either comes down to the fact that you're so showy. Is that Sutton's grapefruit juice that you're drinking?
Yeah, but no, I drink, guys, people on YouTube, I drink water and then I put a little crystal light in it and it makes it a pinkish color.
Literally, I was like, that is the color of Sutton's ocean spray that she pulls out of her purse.
That's what I do. I have a Beyonce has hot sauce in her purse and I have ocean spray.
Listen, I'm not against it. But anyways, so with Dorit, I mean, look, she is a very, from what we've seen in the past, very showy with the labels, with this, that, PK maybe as well. Maybe they were just like in over their heads. Remember when she bought the first season they were on the show, like he bought her this crazy colored Bentley or something. Like, they were the typical annoying, over the top, showy couple. I don't think they're that anymore, but that's what they were. So those kinds of people draw attention.
Yeah, no, definitely. So there is a world in which I could believe that could all happen. Mm-hmm. I just also, there have been, and this is what's wrong with like 360 viewing, is that we all know PK has had financial struggles. We know that he had a gambling issue. Also, it makes me laugh to no end that he went and moved in with Boy George at a hotel for 2 weeks. I was like, talk about an odd couple.
He didn't move in. Don't forget that. He didn't move in, Andy.
Yeah, he just stayed.
He just stayed there. He stayed there, but it's semantics because words have weight.
Yeah. I did that. Boy, George, what should we watch tonight in our hotel room? I just love
the thought of them. We do karaoke. Do you think Garcelle just can't stand Dorit? That so no matter what 100%. Dorit says, like 100%. She's so annoyed with Dorit.
100%. I think also if you're around a person, like you were saying, if they're long-winded, myself included, I think eventually it gets annoying. So I think at a certain point also when that long-winded, if you never come to a point, and you're also saying potentially offensive things and you never seem to learn, even though people have held her hand and explained many times why certain things, like I imagine at a certain point you do just kind of write that off. And Garcelle does have to watch that a little bit because there will be a moment where the tables will turn a little bit and Garcelle she'll have the hot potato and it'll be interesting to see when, because the show comes for everybody at some point. I think that's what's so frustrating about that. Yeah. Well, that's why I think that's so frustrating about Kyle. She's fighting against having that hot potato. And it's like, girl, this is your year. You know, like, I'm so sorry, but this is the year. And her fighting against it has made sometimes more of a mess of it and made the show go in weird ways with like esophaguses and stuff like that when we actually have real material to focus on.
Yeah. I mean, the whole esophagus gate really started because Kyle put that in Anna Marie's head. I mean, yeah. Kyle brought Anna Marie over to... Listen, 8.5 got thrown in as like a pinch hitter for Teddy Mellencamp or for anyone else that couldn't be there.
Oh, I have a theory, though. We saw another clip of Freddie Mellencamp, I call her, last night. And we saw two clips the week before. I think they are buttering or warming us up for a Freddie Mellencamp return to Beverly Hills next season. And by the way, not because they love her, but because they're throwing it in to sweeten the pot to get Kyle back.
Oh my God, Ryan. Okay, so I am actually friends with Teddy in real life. I know you're not the biggest fan. That's okay. I totally understand. I see why. She drove me crazy as a housewife. Really,
yeah, I don't know her personally. I'm talking about what I've seen.
You would actually really like her in person, but that's what I'm saying. I like her as a person. But
Donna,
but
I'm sure I would like all of these people. That's the thing.
I didn't like her as a housewife. Like it really. So anyway, I saw that clip last night and I thought to myself, this is weird. They are going to bring Teddy back next season. They've done it with Tamara now. Teddy is hugely famous and popular in the podcasting space.
Yes.
They're going to bring her back. And because Kyle needs a person.
Yes.
She needs She cannot be on that show without a friend.
That's what I was thinking. I was like, this is so weird that we keep seeing these clips of this. And I think Freddie also, I'll call her Teddy because you like her. Teddy wants it. I think Teddy would want it too, because I think Teddy almost feels like she needs to avenge her performance from earlier seasons and show people what she can really bring it. She can I think that would be interesting to see. And I might, my word of advice that she'll never hear is when you get back on the show, don't push too hard. Don't push too hard immediately. Don't get like insane immediately to show the audience what you can do. Like don't be an Anna Marie. Don't immediately get one bone and just attack it all season. Like, get a lay of the land and especially because
let's be honest. I mean, I'm not saying anything that out of school. Most fans are not huge fans of Teddy because they loved Lisa Vanderpump and they were upset with how that went down. So if she does come back, I would love to see like a redemption moment for her if possible. The problem is I think Teddy is very, very good at like getting what she wants, saying what she wants. Like she calls herself, you know, like Teddy Walters or whatever. She kind of doesn't care in a weird way. And maybe she does care, but she acts like she doesn't care. And saying stuff like she said with Sutton and the purse vodka, like it just goes to show she's like, I'm here to play. Like she's not going to. Or the Vicky squash the beef comment about where were you on January 6th in Vegas at BravoCon. So like, I don't think Teddy has it in her to play chill.
I mean, it'll be interesting. But I do think that's where we're headed and I want everybody to prepare for that. And
I will say, fans are gonna lose their shit.
No, because I said it sooner or later, it's going to happen. And if it doesn't happen on Beverly Hills, maybe it'll happen on OC. I mean, Tamara will do something, you know, like, so I do think that's going to happen. Then at the end of this, we got a like 40 minutes into the episode, we see Kathy like stroll up to her trailer midday in like, you know, rollers and a like loungewear. And it was, but like we get one scene of her and she immediately starts spilling more information that we would have never gotten from Kyle going like, well, I don't, I, I think this is not in the last couple of months. I think she's probably been thinking about Maurice the last 3 or 4 years leaving him. And I was like, finally, we're now getting some, like, we're now getting some information.
I'm just like in shock that Kathy allowed cameras to film her in that state.
Well, first off, I don't even know if Kathy realizes those are cameras. Like, I sometimes think they're just oblivious. It's like Sheree and the Traitors. Like, I don't think she knows she's in Scotland. Idea. Like, so I, there is also a, what the, like, who gives a fuck nature about Kathy unless
her in a weird way,
but at the same time, oh God, I do too. Even though I do realize why people are scared of her, but Paris and Love season two, you saw how controlling she is on narratives, you know, including Paris Hilton's, her daughter's book. So It is interesting when she allows herself to be seen in certain ways that some people would think would be unbecoming. But also, do you think there's like this vibe of, I understand Kathy should be there because Kyle even talked about the unresolved issues with Kathy earlier in the season. So I think it puts a cap on that. But there's also a little bit of a protector of like, anybody picks on my sister, I will fucking destroy you.
Yeah, it was a really weird decision to bring her back. She's not been in the show. They only mention her in that one time about Dorit standing up for Kathy in that moment. Like, it did feel a little bit left field to have her thrown in there, almost like as a life raft for Kyle. Like, Kyle could not handle doing this and being in the hot seat throughout the entire thing. She needed like a little bit of a deflector, protector, or whatever, because she always has that one person next to her. But Kathy... knowing Kathy, she probably is like, oh, this is not Paris in Love. I don't need makeup on before I come on. Like, no one watches this silly show, Beverly Hills. Like, I feel like Kathy is so, it's so shocking to me. And just watching her, like, I would pay money. Like, I would do a Bravo.com subscription just to watch a show of Kathy, Kyle, and Kim. Just the three of them. Oh, I'm so interested in their dynamic and their crazy like history and like all the shit. When Kyle mentioned that she's been working out since she was 15 because her sisters were skinny, did you notice that? Yeah. She said, I have had to work out since I'm 15 because I'm curvy and my sisters are sticks. And I'm like, that's a crazy thing to say out loud, that you had to work out because your sisters were skinny.
If you, I mean, there, I would love an actual docuseries about the Hiltons, about Big Kath, their mom, you all know, about like the all, because it is, if you read about the mom, you guys, and you can, you know, they always talk about, you know, their mom in so many different ways that I would love a docuseries that they participated in, but did not have final edit control. Like that I would, so to be able to really, but you see this, and I don't know if you watch Love is Blind, but. Well,
you joking?
But, I mean, yesterday with Clay's dad and talking about the dad cheating and you see how this has messed up Clay his entire life. Mm-hmm. And it is interesting just like how parents really do in certain ways imprint on their children's in really negative ways. And I think Big Kath, you see the psychoses of the three of those daughters. And, you know, Kathy's ready to rumble about her mom anytime. Kyle's scared of Kathy. Kim is just trying to, you know, color on walls still. And she's such a sweetheart. But I don't know, the Kathy of it all, too, at the very end, if you caught it for the preview for next week, you guys, she's starting to get asked about Morgan. And Kathy goes, don't be embarrassed, Kyle, which is also a very telling word. Why would you say, why would somebody be embarrassed? Would he be embarrassed because you were with a woman now romantically? Like,
do you really
it's a very telling word.
Do you really think that that was edited in the same? Like, do you really think she said that about the Morgan question or about something else?
I do. I think 100% about the Morgan. No, I think there's been a lot of Frankenstein editing that we've already seen already. You know, very simple things and big things. You know, one being, you know, why Sutton passes out or starts to get shaky. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But I do think that was in regards to that specific question. Now, I don't think Kyle comes out on this.
Do you think Kyle comes out?
No, with not Morgan? On this. No. But even last night, they were at the Vanity Fair party together, you know, both having flowers in their hands. And
they were at Chateau Marmont. I will say about Kathy, you know, Kathy is the dynamic between Kathy and Kyle just is so telling, because I agree. Kyle is so petrified of Kathy in some weird way. It's a reminder of her mom. She was the oldest sister. She was the oldest, you know, she was a lot older than Kyle. She was like 20 something and married when Kyle was a little girl. So She is a version of her mother, and Kyle and Maurice have always been such a big wall between this friendship working that's another thing. It's like, why can't we know that? Why can't we say that on the show? Kathy doesn't like my husband. And this is a big problem.
And the reason why is because her husband left Kathy's husband in terms of like win and open the agency. Yes.
Not only competition, did better.
I know. And so there is, Kathy will make people pay. And I think also that's very interesting though, of Kyle is scared of her sister, but also knows other people are scared of her sister on those couches. So I do think that's also an interesting thing of, especially when we get to the Morgan stuff, I want my sister there.
Yeah.
And I do think that is a like hedging her bets, like almost a little insurance policy for Kyle, even though I don't think it's going to work in her favor. But yeah, I don't think she fully comes out. I think she steps right up to the precipice, but I don't think she goes over because Kyle's so protective of her actual life. We complain about it all the time in terms of the show. I think they are definitely something. And I think she wants to make sure every one of her family members is comfortable with it until it's given to us part and parcel, even though we already assume it anyways.
I mean, Kyle's family has to be comfortable with it by now if we're all comfortable with it. Like
Kathy posted her on the grid. Kathy posted Morgan on her grid over the holidays.
I know. It doesn't make any sense. Like, I've already slept with Morgan, I feel like. Like, we're so close with each other. We've decided already that Morgan's part of the family. Like, she's in. The kids
are coming. I want her on the show. I want more Morgan scenes. I hope she comes back next season.
I actually like Morgan's, like, a lot. Her new song is so beautiful that I DM'd her and I said, I love this song. And she responded, thank you so much. And we had a little back and forth. And I think that Morgan is now stalking me on Instagram.
You should blatantly hit on her. So she'd be like, so you can see if you'd be like, sorry, I have a girlfriend. Like, see if she'll admit she has somebody or not.
I should say, listen, I'm really towing the line. I'm with my man, but I'm thinking it's time.
Exactly. See what she says. It would be great if like Kyle and Morgan show up to your doorstep. Like,
Haven't I gotten in enough trouble with podcaster drama? Do I have to also now be the third woman in Kyle and Morgan's relationship?
It'd be great for the podcast. It would be really great for the podcast.
No, daily I dose think of it's- Morgan.
Oh, that'd be great. Like at the end of the day, I don't care. I think what makes it not funny, but what makes it, you know, is just the holding on to, like, you know, you're on a reality show. Like, it's not like you're an accountant where this would be easy. You're on a reality show. So to like kind of toe the line or try to like not tell us, you don't need to tell us everything, but you can at least admit this. I think it's like you picked the wrong profession right now to be in.
I know. Just wait for March 22nd and Buying Beverly Hills. We'll get a lot of info.
Yeah,
there.
We have a lot of conversations between Mauricio and Kyle and Mauricio and the daughters. And I'm kind of bummed. Like, my home team is Bravo. And I'm like, why are they getting more information than we're getting?
I don't know. Is Netflix pulling us over? Are we transitioning to Netflixers?
Or are they going to buy Bravo? Like, that'd be great. They buy just Bravo flat out. What's your take on all the Bravo lawsuits, the reality reckoning, Leah McSweeney today? Andy Cohen's lawyers hit back at Leah McSweeney and, you know, threatened legal action if she did not remove the cocaine comment about him doing cocaine with other housewives or employees and said, listen, the truth still matters. You need to remove this or we will take legal action. Her lawyers fired back already and said, this is just another bullying tactic that you use your, you know, position and power to try to make our client fearful. What is your take on all of this?
Well, look, I'm not a Leah fan. I never have been. Even when she was on the show beginning, I really always got a bad feeling from her. It's a very confrontational, kind of negative Nelly type of vibe. I don't know how to explain it, but I have not been a huge fan of hers. However, if she had a really good case and something real that I thought was, had merit to it, then I would be on her side. However, you can't throw out that this, whether or not it actually has happened, whether or not Andy Cohen has ever actually done cocaine or not, you can't say that without having actual proof of it.
Yeah, you so better have
throw
like
it out
you,
there.
Well, that's the Donna. That's what confuses me, and I also bring it Rachel's lawsuit into this as well. Is that there's pieces of this that it's like with Rachel's lawsuit, you had the James Kennedy kicking the dog at the table, being abusive to Kristen Doty, and Rachel's lawsuit had nothing to do with DJ James Kennedy, but they throw this in to immediately grab some headlines, to also then be able to fit in with Bethany's reality reckoning of painting a picture of overall horribleness with all people Bravo. And I feel like that a little bit with the Leah McSweeney thing of, oh, we got to get some headlines. Let's throw in the cocaine thing, even though Leah McSweeney has never done cocaine with Andy Cohen, it says. So it is interesting what you can allow in these legal papers to like flourish the story and make it more juicy and exciting and grab those headlines. And that's the frustrating part, is that you better have some hardcore proof and not, I heard from a friend from a friend.
Yeah. I mean, it's a big deal, and it really is a career. I don't think doing cocaine with housewives would be a career ender, but technically if he's like their boss and it's in the workplace and stuff, those things have ramifications. Bravo is owned by NBC Universal. It's not a small little, you know, boutique company. And so there's a lot of legal ramifications, and his career could be over based on something like this. Because if Matt Lauer is pressing a button to lock a door and then you're doing cocaine, it's like, what's the difference here? It's inappropriate behavior.
Inappropriate from a higher up, but they keep throwing the Matt Lauer example out there. Mm-hmm. There is a difference between pressing a button and pressuring, you know, employees to have sex. And, you know, we're not hearing like Andy pressed a button and he forced me to do rails of cocaine until I couldn't sleep for a week. Like there's like different, like sex and drugs, they're in this same kind of like ether, but they're not the same. You know, it is abusive in any way you cut it. But I do think what Matt Lauer did is very different than what they are accusing Andy Cohen of.
100%. And we can't take away from the fact that like it is not your normal employer-employee relationship. Just when Kyle Richards, I said this on my show, when Andy comes into Kyle's trailer at the Beverly Hills reunion and just kind of scares her for a joke saying Mauricio is coming on the reunion today.
She's like, fuck you.
Kyle goes, it's like, shut the fuck, you're fucking kidding me.
Yeah.
You would never say that to your boss if you had a very serious boss, you know?
Yeah.
They don't have that relationship. Obviously, they've partied together many times. So there's also a big nuanced issue here. Also, another thing is Matt Lauer was, people like Matt Lauer, Harvey Weinstein, these people, yes, they were using sexual favors from other opposite sex. Andy is a gay man joking about like having fun with friends. Also, finally, in terms of the drugs, people could say, oh, well, he probably, you know, you would feel like you'd have to do drugs so that he liked you. Well, no, because Andy's really close with a lot of sober housewives. There's a lot of sober people in Andy's life. In fact, John Hill, his co-host on his show, is sober. Andy has a lot of, and Anderson Cooper, from what we know, is not a big partier. Like, that's a bullshit excuse that you have to do drugs to be in Andy's space.
Coterie of housewives.
Coterie. Yeah,
I think that's the thing. But anybody can say anything these days. And I just want to think, like, why are we essentially doing this? Are we doing it for a cash grab? Are we trying to get better working conditions? What is it? And I think sometimes with me, you know, you're a woman in this, so I can't speak about it in a way that you can. We do want to believe all women. We do realize that there is huge injustices, and there always has been, in men and women dynamics. I mean, is there a part of you that says, hey, Bravo does need to change? These women, you know, this reality reckoning and Bethany and Rachel, there is a huge point that maybe sometimes I'm not seeing because I'm a man.
I don't want to sound like not with the women, you know, not standing with the women, but no, because I think, you know, yes, maybe there's some stuff like in production that needs to change. Like, I'm friends with a lot of producers, camera operators, people behind the scenes, you know, who have told me about injustices and things happening kind of like from the top down in that sense, working their asses off in unsafe conditions, et cetera, et cetera. But when it comes to the talent, especially in a show like a Bravo show, you know what you're signing up for, just like Clay did on Love is Blind. You're signing up for fame. You're signing up for followers. You're signing up for future, you know, collaborations and businesses. And ideally you have a great run on the show, but you're not signing up on a Real Housewife or for any of these shows for any other reason than that. Not for like some self-growth or like, you know, you're never even like, you know, Jenna Lyons signed up for that show. She's like, I have a business to sell. Like, I'm doing this for my lashes business. Most people are very straightforward about that. So whether or not bad behavior happens, I think that it can be. I think bad things happen in these cases because alcohol is involved, ratings are involved. Just like you said, money is involved. And at the end of the day, they're willing to sell their souls for money, not just the talent, but the producers and the execs, let's be honest. So maybe some changes need to be done on a zoomed out like perspective, but there's always going to be another star. There's always going to be another show. There's always going to be another talent. And unfortunately, it's like, I hate to say it, but if you join a sorority that you know they're going to be like hazing you like crazy, then maybe, you know, don't complain once you start getting hazed. Don't join the sorority. Don't like go out a different route.
Well, you can also point to a like a huge swath of these housewives that are super successful, that do credit the show doing great things. I mean, like, you know, all these people that came to Andy's defense, like Heather Dubrow and all of these people, it just seems to be the people that are financially secure. They're pretty okay with everything. It's the people that seem down on their luck that really all of a sudden seem to have like, you know, think all of this has been great injustice. And I think at the end of the day, I keep saying, I think Bethany wants to be Andy Cohen. And the only way to be Andy Cohen is to potentially take down Andy Cohen in her head.
Bethany is taking down Andy Cohen, in my opinion, 100% because of her ego being bruised. Because in that
the episode, Watch What Happens Live,
I really think
Jeff
that
Lewis,
was,
yeah,
it was, it, of course,
it,
of
it course all comes down to Jeff Lewis. It all comes down to like literally, Jeff Lewis made fun of her, which by the way, see, he was right though. She was doing a Housewives recap podcast like we all do. And he was like, how original, you know?
And also, by the way, she had been so obviously against doing anything Housewives related. It all yes. made sense. And Andy, being the creator of the Housewives executive producer, and it's his baby, probably got a little butthurt by her going around saying, I hate the Housewives. They're all stupid. They're all idiots.
How would you not? I mean, like, that's the funny thing. Like, I just love
it. He probably originally felt hurt by her, meaning you're taking down my baby. Why? And then when she came to him and said, I have this show, I want to promote it on your show. He was like, I'm going to dig her a little bit. I'm going to give her a little bit of her own medicine. Oh, I thought you said it was stupid. That was enough for Bethany. Like Bethany is one of those people. I guarantee you Jason Hoppe and Bethany divorced because Jason once said like to Bethany, I don't think skinny girl dressings are good. Like, I think he said that one comment to her. He was like, the skinny girl turkey breast was like shit. And she was like, that's it. I want a divorce.
Yes. Yes, exactly. I mean, like it is. I mean, Erica Jane even had that comment on the reunion of like, listen, you fuck with me, I'll take you down to the grave with me or something like that. And I do think there are certain people out there like that, that they just can't let it go. They will scrap and scrap and scrap. So I don't see this going away anytime soon. But I do think at this point, Bethany is fully leveraging any power that she has at this point. You know, and I find that sometimes like short-sighted in the long term, because when you do these attacks so publicly, I think it also makes other companies a little skittish on getting into bed with you business-wise.
Who would ever want to get into business with any of these people? And I hate to say it, it happens like on Love is Blind. Any of these talents that come after the show that hired them, it's like people are going to run away from you because if they find out that you're someone that is, you know, gets mad and then wants to fight back, it's too dangerous. It's like insurance. Yeah, you would run away from that. I'm with you.
As we start winding down, what's your favorite show on Bravo right now?
Okay, Summer House. I'm going to have to go really? Summer House. Oh, I'm okay, so all in on Summer House right now.
And so we're at the third episode tonight. Mm-hmm. You know, Lindsay obviously had the unfortunate stuff with Carl, Cocaine Carl. Obviously, Carl probably got his cocaine from Andy Cohen.
Carl is the coterie of Housewives. He is one of the coterie.
It's the coterie of Housewives and Carl. No, I mean, that was such a brutal moment that we got to see that started filling in the pieces for us of why Carl was skittish on getting married. But you're right. Like, I have loved the first two episodes of Summer House because it doesn't have the negative attachment that I have with Vanderpump Rules right now. It has a lot of like, I kind of like, why do you like it?
Well, I mean, it's enjoyable to watch, number one. It makes me happy. Vanderpump bothers me. Like, it angers me in so many ways. I also like that they're shooting it in the exact same style they did last year. Like, Vanderpump feels like a produced Hills show this season, like, with the camera angles.
Yeah, a lot of, like, weird, like, 360 flip
cameras.
I'm getting
dizzy. I'm too old for this. Like, I can't go upside down so fast. And then, also, Summer House, I keep looking at my TV like it's there. Summer House is just, it gives me life. It reminds me of warm times. It reminds me of margaritas in the pool. I love seeing Kyle's mullet. The new cast additions. This West
love the
guy,
two new guys. I mean West especially, but
he's
yeah, they're
a
great
star. And then the other one seems really great too. Like Paige is actually enjoying the season, so she's having fun and she's getting browned out. Paige, our Paige, who always is in bed, was getting drunk. Like this is fun. I'm enjoying. Other than the Carl and Lindsay, like dark, everything else. Who would you rather be married to?
The ratings were down. Like the ratings haven't been great on Summer House, and that doesn't take into account, you know. But that's just same day ratings. But I'm like, God, come on, you guys, this is actually good. I really do love Summer House.
I love Summer House, and I'm loving Southern Hospitality. I know that's on hiatus right now, but
second season is great.
And then I just started watching Vanderpump Villa because I got a screener, and I'm hoping that's going to be like a Southern Hospitality.
I've watched 9 episodes of Vanderpump Villa and 9. It is, yeah, I don't know if I'm allowed to say that, but yeah, I've watched 9 episodes.
I had a bunch,
of that.
But I don't know how many.
It's very, I mean, like it's definitely funny. I mean, it's messy. It's messy. It's like,
but is it messy like Southern Hospitality messy, like young, idiotic?
Yes.
Stupidity.
Young, idiotic. Lisa's. Yeah. I mean, it's a little bit of Below Deck vibes because it's at a villa where they host people at the villa and stuff. And it is funny because it doesn't have the attachment that you have with the Vanderpump characters that you're like, oh, I've seen them mess up so many times. It's like with Southern Hospitality, you watch them mess up and you're like, ah, they're so young, they'll figure it out. Mm-hmm. And so you almost free yourself in watching it. You don't have to feel guilty, you know?
I love that. I want more of those OG type shows that you're not so immersed in, and you don't feel like it's all done as an act. How will my audience like me? You know, it's like if you watch Southern Hospitality and the way Joe Bradley acts, you're like, he's not thinking about the audience in any way right now. He's just being
I think, but now it seems like Joe Bradley is thinking about the audience in terms of who he's dating, it does seem like he really wants to be somebody. And I think that you need that person. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing.
I think it's good casting. I guess, I hate to say it because I really love older casts. I love the Real Housewives cast, but these other shows, like there's this mid 30 year range that like Vanderpump Rules range that I'm like, I don't know. That's why I'm concerned about the Valley. Also, just being a mom here in the Valley, I'm like, am I going to be so annoyed? Are these the people that I would avoid at Mommy and Me class?
Well, you know once again, I mean? We don't know who we're going to root for because we don't think we're going to be rooting for Jax. So who are we going to root for? And then finally, are you watching Miami? Have you dug it so far?
Of course. I think, tonight the last reunion?
Tonight's the last reunion. And they switched. It's been weird with the Bravo scheduling. And it's frustrating because I think it's been a fantastic, like if you compare the Beverly Hills and Miami reunion, it is hysterical how starkly different they are in just terms of noise level. I mean, these ladies are fighting for their lives on Miami, and it is hysterical to watch because they truly feel and believe all of it. And if you're not watching Miami, what a mistake. It has just been so good.
It's so strong and colorful and bright and vibrant and intense and loud and messy. And you definitely need extra Tylenol near you. But it's like every single one of those characters are characters. They're not like there's so many people on Beverly Hills. I don't think Anna Marie said more than one word yesterday. And I don't think she said
it was a pretty good episode.
But I'm saying like on Beverly Hills, even Garcelle and Chris, I mean, Garcelle said a little bit, but Erica, for example, on the Beverly Hills reunion, she just like was sandwiched between Dorit and Kyle. Like it was so weird.
Would you guys bet it all on Blonde? If you want to giggle, I mean, it's like it's so funny. Like Mikey cries like every scene.
So emotional.
The big crux of it too is that like Erica can't tap into her sluttiness of years past, so she can't really get there. And I just think that's like hysterically funny of her trying to writhe around, and it is like the drama of it all is so funny. And there, she at one point, she's trying to take a loan out for $100,000 for like better production stuff, which I was like, man, she should have gone to Diana Jenkins and asked for see is her going to like Lisa Rinna and like asking for like some money to like do the show. That would have been a great scene.
You're right.
But it's so funny. I just thought at the end of the day, I'm like, why? I don't root for Erica. So it's hard to like truly care, but it was fun. What did you think of it?
I thought it was an enjoyable, like it seemed like yeah. a one, like it should have been a little documentary on Netflix, you know, like a behind the scenes music show. I was surprised it was only two episodes and I was surprised they aired them both in one night. That I thought was like a little bit
originally
of a
it was a two night special event when they originally promoted it. It was a two night special event. I remember at BravoCon.
So what happened?
At some point, I don't know. At some point they just must have wanted, they had enough and they wanted to burn through it, I guess.
Yeah. Look, I don't feel so many things for Erica. I lack that. Like maybe she's like, she doesn't have empathy, but I don't have empathy for her. Like there's some sort of weird, but maybe that's because she lacks it for others that it's hard to feel for her.
Well, even last night, she couldn't even say, can you tell us why you visited the victims? I cannot.
What?
I cannot. Why? I'm like, dude, at least like you, like, I don't get being this tough. Like the ego, it's like Sandoval as well. The ego, like telling your brain to like, just be an asshole still when it is proven to not go good for you is why, like, I don't know who you think you're impressing being that hard.
Or it's just like ingrained in you, like principles, and you don't want to feel wrong. And it's more important to seem right. And like, I don't know. It's weird. I also really like to say I'm sorry. I'm a big fan of like apologizing when I mess up.
I apologize before I do the thing that I'm sorry for. Like I just flat out like an apology. Yeah.
I'm the person that bumps, that I get thrown back in a hallway and I'm like, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Like, I am so concerned about upsetting people, and that's why these things are hard for me, because I am a people pleaser. I've had to learn away from that, but she's the opposite. She's like a people upsetter. She doesn't give a shit. And I think that was hard. The only part, I mean, I did like the Mikey drama with her, like how he was like, take the mics off. Like, we have to take the mics off.
Yeah. You're not bringing it, girl. You are not bringing it. Yeah. We're going to cut the bed number.
Turned on by you slithering, touching your vagina. But what I noticed about Erica in last night's Bet It All on Blonde, two things. She has zero energy. I don't know if it's the Ozempic. She's constantly asking for donuts. It's weird.
Yeah.
She's like
little bites
she's
of
like
donuts
on
yeah.
something.
She yeah, that's I texted my friend. I said she's so not clunky was the word, but just stiff in her movement. You know, for like somebody. And also, it's so funny because on Beverly Hills, she always makes so many jokes about how much sex she has and how sexual she is. And then you get her on stage and she can't do that. And I'm like, hey, does Sutton need to come on stage and teach you how
pants?
To do this? Yeah.
Sutton brought pants. Sutton brought the funny. Dollars. And then another thing I really did actually like was the one moment when you saw her with her old dog. Her dog that was really
100%.
Old.
My heart went out to Tiago and Erica in that moment. And the dog passed away 1 month after she started her Vegas residency at House of Blues or wherever that was. And I that was very sad.
But when you see this dog who literally has a hard time standing up, and the way she carries him around and cares for him, it's like a side of Erica we never see, that nurturing, loving side.
And that's the side that I think really works. And it's the side that she refuses to show. And I just think that is so, and that's what I guess at the end of the day, it doesn't make her interesting, but it makes her a character, because we all have that one thing that you're like, man, you don't even realize how you come off, but you're so committed to the bit that we have to read between the lines. And we know there is a heart in there somewhere, but you can only show it to potentially animals or older men you're getting money from. Sorry. Yeah. I said that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you're right. Do you think that she, I don't know. Do you think that she is a, like, I don't know. I don't know. I guess Erica to me is someone that she is such a character and such a part of the show, an important part of the show. But at the same time, like, I don't know what her longevity is. Like, I don't know where she goes.
Yeah, that made me sad because, I mean, listen, they said it was a success, the show. But we do know the ticket sales weren't great. We do. But also, that's not, you know, in Hollywood, it's all about perception. So if she can put it out there, maybe she'll be getting other gigs and stuff, but it did make me sad at the end of the day because, you know, at this point, there was one point where Erica, it could have been the sky's the limit for her because she was doing like, you know, the gay clubs and all of these things and then got the opportunity to get on Beverly Hills. Like she had everything, like the sky was the limit. She gets Chicago. And so I don't know, like it made me sad because I think she was even realizing what is the longevity at this point. Where do you go from here? And if your whole image is sex, you better really bring that sex, not just for the gay men, but for any other man and woman that comes in to see you. And I don't know that there was elements where I know she wouldn't want this, but I did feel bad for her.
Yeah. Yeah, no. And I think I just like had a vision all of a sudden, like Raven Simone. Remember how Raven Simone would have those like psychic visions? I had a vision that we're going to be watching a special on, if it's Bravo or somewhere else, in like 30 years. And it's going to be Where Are They Now? Housewives edition. And we're going to be able to watch all these housewives like 30 years later.
Well, imagine this. If BravoCon keeps going 30 years from now, we're going to have to watch all these housewives sell their wares, get older, keep showing up. And I guess that's what we want, but it becomes like a gigantic, like Star Trek, Star Wars convention where you see like little bit parts and like Mikey Minden will be signing in the gold booth at 2 p.m. And that'll be great. Finally, Traders, who's going to win tonight?
It better be CT, but I don't think it is. But CT has my heart.
What a sweet moment between CT and Phaedra last week. I just thought that's how great the season is.
We sit next to each other at the reunion. We know they're
They air the reunion right after the Traitors episode tonight. So that's it. I think it's going to be Sandra that wins. I think, because I think she caught on Kate's little comment last week in regards when Phaedra was leaving, saying you play selfishly. And that was a weird thing to say. And I think Sandra tuned into that. And Sandra all of a sudden is like, with her braces, I think it's Kate. It's Kate. And I think she's going to come in out of nowhere and take the whole thing potentially. I don't think Kate's going to win.
I don't remember how it works. So if they get Kate the traitor out and it's faithfuls left, how many faithfuls get left at the end? I don't even remember them. Because last year we had a traitor. Either.
I remember Ceri lied to them and like kept all the money that she could have split. Yeah, but Ceri was the traitor.
So like what happens if faithfuls are left?
To tell you the truth, I don't know. I'm so excited to find out. Like I love the show so much. Don't know the rules. And I don't even know if the Traitors knows the rules. Like, I don't even know if the show knows their own rules, because I'm so confused week after week with sometimes how they'll just like throw a new thing in there. So regardless, it is just great television. And I'm so happy that we had this season.
Me too. I think it's amazing. And I don't know how you can go back to just like normies on that show. I always want just reality stars and Phaedra.
Yeah, completely. So what's coming up with you, Donna? You have a daily show. And also, but this is this brand consult. Like, I need your help. Brand, are you still brand image consulting? What are you doing?
Well, I really kind of like stepped a little bit away from that, but I do help people if they want to start their podcasts and stuff. So I still have a lot of clients that I do that with.
What about people that started their podcast and don't know what the fuck they're doing?
I think you're doing pretty damn fine, Ryan. Are you joking me? So bad.
I actually wasn't joking. I was like, maybe I could use Donna's help.
You're fine.
No, it's just there's a lot of, I'm just always
behind the scenes stuff. Okay. Well, we can chat. Yeah. But I think in general, I look at someone like you. You've been doing this for a few years. I don't remember when you started. Started during the pandemic?
1933. Pandemic. Yeah.
I mean, you've killed it. Obviously you have great shows, great guests. You're working with Betches. Like, you're doing so much. Yeah. So maybe my brand like consulting is like, chill out, Ryan, chill out for a second.
You know what? I think it was, I've been honest about that. I think that I even started like when, mom was dying. And then when she died, it was like, I was running to, I was trying to get as big as possible so she could see it.
Oh my gosh.
And that was a crazy thought because, she would get so excited about certain things. And then afterwards, I think it has been sometimes, speaking about Sandoval, like sometimes to not have to sit in my feelings is that I'll do so much just to stay away from sometimes the bad feelings. And that's not a boo hoo, woe is me. It is like, that is really sometimes like I feel like I'm running out of time or I'm chasing something. And that can be a lot on the audience to have to keep up with so much content, but it sometimes helps me or like gives me something to do or shoot for. But that's just a couple of thoughts I've been having.
You know what you should do is you should listen to, do you listen to Kristen Cavallari ever? Random for you.
Wait, I really didn't see that that's where you're headed with that. I did not think that.
This week on Kristen Cavallari's podcast, it just comes up on my YouTube feed. So I started watching it and I love her. But she talks about her experience doing something called BUFO, which is this, like we mentioned it earlier. It's like an ayahuasca. Yeah. But it's about trying to kind of like see her way through grief because her brother died 3 years ago. And she's talking all about like this horrible like grief that comes through her like that. And how just basically a lot of what she's learned, it takes it away from this feeling of I'll never see him again. He doesn't know what's going on because she feels so confident that he is there and that he is seeing it. So like this idea of I wanted my mom to see everything before she passed, like she's watching, she's good. She's watching and sees you and you don't want to burn out, right? Like I don't want you to burn out, but I mean, if you're happy, then you keep going.
Well, happy is relative to me. I don't know if that truly exists for me right now, but I'm just thinking about my mom using my product code in heaven. Like, you so bad 50, Mom, if you're listening. So bad 50. Go to quince.com, Mom. Go to quince.
What are they selling up in heaven?
Go to betterhelp.com, Mom. So bad 50.
BetterHelp is sponsoring my show this week, too.
They love to sponsor.
They love us.
So what's coming up for you? Like, too, it's a daily show.
It's a daily show.
You can watch YouTube or you can listen to the podcast. Mm-hmm. And you cover all the hot topics, all the shows. You cover even outside of Bravo. I saw you were talking about the Sister Wives tragedy the other day. And, you know, it's a good one-stop shop place. What are your overall goals? Where do you want to go for the show?
I would love to grow the show. I'm just following in So Bad It's Good's footsteps. So, like, whatever you do, I'm doing it 2 years later. It's been such a blessing and so much fun. I would love to just keep growing and get the show bigger and bigger audience. But I really enjoy doing it. Like it really is my happiness.
You do fall in love with it. Like you do fall in love with it. I mean, if you are willing to put the work in, there is such a deep love that comes with it that it's so hard to explain to people, but you get it, you know?
We should do a podcasters meetup with all like the Los Angeles podcasters that do this. We should like do an event, a live event.
That's the other thing. I want to do live shows eventually. So I got the thing is, and I'm really like, I'm just scared to see if anybody would come to it. But like, because there's like a video element I already have, like, I know exactly what it would be. But that's the one thing I'm like scared just to actually push myself to do it. You know?
I know you're scared, but trust me, people would come. You're a big show, Ryan. And I think I think you'd be surprised.
Yeah. I'll come. Well, okay, good. There's one. And by the way, if people don't come, I'm going to sue you, just like Leah McSweeney is suing. I'm like, she pumped my head full of lies. You can listen to the podcast. But also, you guys, go subscribe to Daily Dose of Donna. But also, I know this always sounds silly when I say it, but it's not silly. Go rate it 5 stars on Apple Podcasts and Spotify, because those things really do help for placement. You know, the algorithm of Apple is so weird and finicky, and you don't really understand how it works, but if you do rate those things, from what I'm told through the years, that does help your podcast show up on other people's like suggested podcasts and things like that. So we want to make sure there's good voices out there that we can listen to, because there's so many great voices to support out there. Is there anything else coming up that we need to know about or support you with?
Yes, I'm going through a really tough time. If you wouldn't mind coming over for a glass of wine, everyone, tonight, I would like to be supported. No, everything's good. I'm just doing the show Monday through Friday, and then join the Facebook group if you want another place to chat reality TV. I'm sure you have one as well. And that's that. And I'm going to for sure have you back on my show at some point soon.
This is great. It's an open relationship like Kyle and Mauricio have, but we just go on each other's podcasts and talk shop. So Daily Dose of Donna Bowling, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Ryan.